Morning Shade 4-5. Just that trailer alone doesn't begin to encapsulate all the energy, all the information, all the history, all the tragedy, all the high times, all the low times that made up this journey, that still continues to make up this journey of one of the greatest groups to ever come out of hip-hop culture to ascend over an impoverished environment, disenfranchised areas, and become heroes and become a story of glory, the Wu-Tang Clan of Mics and Men, which is available right now on Showtime. I talked about him earlier. Mm-hmm. He's a filmmaker, a musician, an artist, a chronicler of hip-hop, a writer, a producer, a director, and just all-around great guy, somebody whose work I trust wholeheartedly. I could read something he wrote blindly, and I doubt if I would question anything that he put out into the world, because I know he does the due diligence. He's here today, the director of the docuseries, the one and only good friend, Sasha Jenkins.
Hey. Yo!
Sasha.
Thanks for having me, guys.
Legend.
Ah, man, good to have you, man. We're going to get into this. You just handed me some vinyl, man,
Yeah,
what is this vinyl you just handed me, man?
The band is called the 1865. I'm the lead guitarist. Why are we called the 1865? Well, we know what happened in 1865. Then flash forward to Obama getting elected and felt good.
Mm-hmm.
After 1865, there's a good 10, 15 years where black people were coming up, and then this group called KKK kicked in, and then a gentleman named Jim Crow stepped up.
Yeah.
So after Obama was out of the office, this new guy comes in. So the point is, history repeats itself.
History
should be your best friend. History is my best friend, because if you study history and understand that your ancestors have been through what you're going through now and even worse and overcame it,
mm-hmm.
that should be should put a battery in your back and help you get through it. And so the band is all black, Strong Sister in the front,
mm-hmm.
and we play rock and roll because we were the pioneers of rock and roll.
Absolutely. People forget that or don't even really necessarily know that we were the pioneers of rock and roll, correct?
Right.
So who are the members of the band? How'd you get together? Is this like a passion project? Or
I mean, I've been in groups for many years. Our lead singer, Honeychild Coleman, is just an amazing talent. And a gentleman named Chuck Treese, who was the first black skater on the cover of Thrasher, played mm-hmm. on the record. A woman named Flora Lucchini's in the band playing bass, and my man Biz is on drums. And, you know, one's from Chicago, one's from D.C. I mean, we come from all different places, but we represent the totality of what it means to be, you know,
a rock and roll artist.
Many things.
Yeah. Okay, all right. So Elvis wasn't the first rock and roll artist?
No, but Elvis was a big fan of black music.
Okay.
And I don't really blame Elvis. I blame his manager. His manager was the one who was real messed up.
It was real messed up. Who was Elvis a fan of that you know of through your research?
I mean, he was from the hood, mm-hmm. first of all, and he would go to Beale Street, mm-hmm. am I saying it right? And go to the black clubs. He was the white dude in the back listening. You know,
mm-hmm.
he's a fan. The reason why people like Elvis is because, yes, Elvis did have some talent, but his talent was inspired by black people. He would tell you that.
Yeah. Do you feel like we're seeing what we saw happen with rock and roll and how black folks got dismissed out of the narrative? Is that possible to happen at all with hip hop?
Well, rock and roll, jazz, blues, hip hop, it's identity. That's what everyone has to recognize.
Yeah.
You know, when you become an MC, you choose a name. My last name is Jenkins. That is not from Africa,
mm-hmm.
right? So when you become a graffiti writer and you choose a name, the power and the ownership that comes over that name, that's identity.
Mm-hmm.
Rock and roll is identity. And when the music industry came in and realized, well, you can put a white person here doing this kind of music, at first it was scary. When Elvis was doing what he was doing in the beginning, white people were afraid that they were going to be taken over by the savages. This guy's moving like a savage. But eventually, the music industry says, hey, if we get our kids to play this music, we'll sell more records. So that's what happened with rock and roll. So then rock and roll became, quote unquote, white identity,
mm-hmm.
right? And fewer black people identified with it. But that's clearly not the truth. And so for a long time, we have been separated from our identity. And what hip hop has done has empowered a lot of people, not just black people or brown people, but people who are fans of hip hop. It's empowered them and has given them an identity. And that's why so many people bringing it to Wu-Tang.
Yeah.
Why so many people love Wu-Tang, because when you see that W, it doesn't just represent a rap group. It represents an identity, represents a way of life. And for so many people around the world, that W was their first introduction to hip hop.
Mm-hmm. Man, Sasha Jenkins here, man. I want to play something off the 1865 Don't Tread on Me project.
Nice, I want to hear it.
It's a song called Runaway Bride. Set this up for us, man. What is this about?
Well, the whole album is based on a town post-1865 from the perspective of lots of different people. So Runaway Bride is basically about the slave master who's in love with his slave who wants to marry her to create a level of freedom, but she's not really with it.
She's not with it. Nah. All right, here it is, man. 888-742-3345. We're going to talk Wu-Tang Clan when we come back. Give us a call. The 1865 Don't Tread on Me is the project. That was Runaway Bride, track number 7.
Don't Tread on We, actually.
Excuse me, Don't Tread on We?
Yeah, Don't Tread on We. You know the history behind the flag with the one snake, Don't Tread on Me. We don't made it. Flipped it, Don't Tread on We with two snakes.
Don't Tread on We.
As in us, not just the individual. America sometimes promotes the idea of the individual, and there's nothing wrong with that, but certain people, that idea of the individual is tough. Mm-hmm. We need a group of people together.
And that's how you came up with Don't Tread on We.
That's right.
Sasha Jenkins. I was trying to give you the
radio. Yeah, I heard it, man. It was sounding good.
Yeah, then I messed up on the end. My bad, man.
Sound good.
Sound great. Sound tight, man. Y'all hit tight, man. How do y'all, when you're creating music, are y'all just jamming and taking the best parts of the jam, or how do y'all write your songs?
I sit in my bedroom and I write riffs, record them into my phone. Then I go through my phone and say, this one will go good with this one, blah, blah, blah. Send it to Honeychild. We talk about what the concept is, and she comes back. We go in the booth, and a lot of times I'm hearing it for the first time, and I'm, you know, you heard her voice. I mean, she can sing. So I don't know. Things come to me. A voice tells me to do something. About a year and a half, 2 years ago, a voice told me to do this band, and here we are.
Here you
Mass
are.
Appeal Records. Shout out to the team. Thank
Absolutely.
You so much.
Mass Appeal, man. Y'all killing it over there. Conceptually, like with the music, like you hear a storyline in this song and you kind of put it in context, but every song has that kind of parallel, like things people were probably going through then and what we're going through now.
Yeah, I mean, there's a song called Peggy about a woman who's a slave who decides to kill her children because she believes they're better off in heaven than being captured again and being slaves. And that's real. That really happened.
Yeah.
You know, so... Again, my idea is history is my best friend, and I think that there are ways to incorporate history in projects that engage people. And, you know, you could be a person who's not into anything black and just listen to the music and not pay attention to the lyrics, and I think you can still get something from it.
All right. Is that one of the approaches to the Wu-Tang Clan of mics and men? History is our best friend. I don't know if our history is always chronicled properly. You know, and so I look to certain people that tell the full story and really cover it from not just from an industry perspective or just from a fan perspective, but what you were able to do in this series is humanize a lot of these guys we look at as superheroes, or we see them as their personas. But then when you start learning the background to their story and how Wu-Tang actually formed, even prior to being called Wu-Tang Clan, it gives us, it makes them even more relatable to me in 2019. But how hard was it, like, to bring this vision together, or did you just start and said, let me see what it takes us, and we'll mold it to where it need to be?
I mean, first of all, rest in peace and shout out to John Singleton.
Okay,
yes.
Right?
Absolutely.
John Singleton was a native, and that's why when he made Boys in the Hood, it resonated, right? Those characters were real. They weren't coming from a perspective of judgment, right? Flash forward to me doing what I'm doing because of people like John Singleton. I am a native, right? So it's not hard for me to do this, right? Other people get the opportunity and it's easy to just focus on, oh, Wu-Tang, they're great, amazing, you know, wow. But to me, the film isn't even about the music. In order to understand hip-hop, you have to understand the environment from which it's born, because black music is always a reflection of and a reaction to the environment. So I've always wondered, people in Bulgaria love Wu-Tang, right? People in all over the world love Wu-Tang. I'm from Queens, and sometimes I don't understand the slang, right? So I wanted to create a film that really gave you an understanding of what made these guys special and what made them common. Because at the end of the day, this film is really the story of every rapper from the hood who started out bagging groceries, selling newspapers on a Verrazano bridge, having no other opportunities. And like Raekwon says, when you learn that your neighborhood is worth $250,000 a day, that's interesting to me. That would be interesting to any kid in America, right? So then they start selling drugs. But when you understand the backstory of them going to school and having to drive in a bus and you see KKK kill all niggers every day and dealing with the racial strife and the educational system that they're up against, when you understand that, it's not about demonizing them for the choices they made. It's about understanding who they are and why they made those choices. And every rap record you listen to, if you distill it from that perspective, that is where it's coming from. And we don't do that. Oftentimes, there aren't people like me in the position of power to tell these kinds of stories. And so every time I have a platform, whether I'm doing music or I'm making a film, whether it's Burn Motherfucker Burn, which is a film about the so-called riots in Los Angeles, or a film called Word is Bond about rap lyrics, there's always something in there that speaks to society and environment and climate. Because if it wasn't for society, environment, and climate, there would be no hip-hop.
Sasha Jenkins. Also, man, it's also kind of motivational to watch it, because to see how these individuals were able to navigate through this environment, you know, and through the things that they face to become who they are today. Some of the conversations you're hearing in this docuseries are things that most people weren't privy to. Even the issues they faced as men when it came to business decisions, learning about who Divine was, RZA's brother, and how business kind of came in between them at some aspects. Was it hard to get them to talk about these things?
Again, you know, I'm a man of a certain age.
Yeah.
You know, the first magazine cover they were ever on was on my newspaper, Beatdown, which is in the film. Ironically, there's footage of them flipping through it. So there's a level of comfort, you know, and trust. And I'm interviewing them. And I'm not interviewing them. I'm do what you do. It's a conversation, right? And they understand that I'm not there to gotcha. I'm there to, as a man of a certain age who can relate to what you're talking about, I want to hear where you're coming from. I'm giving you an opportunity to speak your mind. And, you know, the interviews are shot in a very dark, quiet environment. Maybe that had something to do with it. But maybe they see someone who looks like them, and there's a level of comfort that I provide. There's a level of understanding, and I have the ability to unlock things that other people might not be able to unlock.
We're talking about Wu-Tang Clan of Mics and Men. Heather, I'm curious, because when I'm looking at the footage, I know where I was at in 93 when the first album came out, but when the singles were being dropped as well in Northern California, and I didn't understand a lot of the slang. I didn't know all the slang. But where were you in Jersey at this time?
Jersey and Staten Island, obviously, we didn't have all this information that we have now, but Jersey and Staten Island is very close. It's like a bridge over, so to speak. We didn't know until the doc and certain interviews individually that some of them originally from Brooklyn and different things like that. But for us, it was Staten Island, and we didn't even know MCs were in Staten Island. Like, let's start there.
Okay.
Because it's over a bridge, but it's far away.
We had the Force MCs were from there.
But that seemed like singing.
Right, they were rappers before, but you're right.
Yeah,
they were known for singing.
It seemed like singing, you know what I mean? Yeah. So it was like when you heard Protect Your Neck, something happened. There was an energy. That's the only word I could put on it. It was an energy. And I remember having a conversation years ago, and I would love to ask you, Sasha, not to compare groups, but what Public Enemy was and is to us as fans and artists in this industry, where would you say Wu-Tang falls in that? Because I remember having an argument when I first heard them and saying that this is going to be like Public Enemy for us. Like, they're going to move. It's going to be a movement. What would you say?
I think the difference is Public Enemy had a very conscious consciousness. They were writing songs very specifically to address things that were, you know, an issue. Where Wu-Tang wrote their music And it was addressing what PE was addressing, but it was more of a direct reflection of how they were feeling. Not that what Public Enemy was doing wasn't coming from true feeling, but it was more conscious to address the ills of what was going on, mm-hmm. where Wu-Tang just gave you the ills. Mm-hmm. And mm-hmm. from their reporting and from their expressing themselves, you got similar kind of information. But I think Public Enemy, Chuck D is a rock and roll kind of guy. And RZA, in some ways, in terms of his production style, because let's keep it 100. When mm-hmm. Wu-Tang first came out, a lot of his contemporaries, God bless a lot of you producer guys, were shitting on him. Like, yo, yeah. this shit is mad yeah. sloppy. Yeah. I don't understand what's going on with this, right? Mm-hmm. That's what it was. But really, RZA was coming off of a bad experience in the music industry where he was told to do his music in a particular way. He was very polished. And he had a horrible experience. And he said, you know what? I don't care anymore. This is what it's going to be. Mm-hmm. And it was a combination of not caring and combination of learning on the job that made it what it was. That's what made it special. Mm-hmm. So hip hop was becoming very conscious of its how it's presented. Mm. Music was, you know, shiny suits and polished. And, mm-hmm. you know, we are always very conscious of how we look, how yeah. we're dressed, right? Hip hop was a reflection of that consciousness. Where Wu-Tang wasn't that, just like Nirvana was, you know, they weren't wearing, you know, spandex. They came wearing flannels.
Yeah.
Wu-Tang came off the street. Sweet. Now, Run DMC did that before, but they were more kind of drug dealer style. Mm-hmm. Wu-Tang, these dudes were just off the street. And that energy and that not really caring and that hunger to get on is what made them that sort of Public Enemy-ish thing yeah. for a new okay. generation of okay. people.
Sasha Jenkins is here. Tracy.
Agreed. Yeah. Yes. You know, Sasha, another big facet of this film, obviously, you know, these nine men are creative idols to so many, and then you really get a bigger glimpse at their egos and how that was the catalyst for so many disagreements and ultimately for, you know, people going separate ways. What have you learned about ego from doing this, and also advice you can give to other collectives so they can strengthen their glue?
Well, you know, in many ways, you know, I can relate to what the Wu-Tang story was, because going back to the publication I used to do, Beatdown, I started with a childhood friend. And we had a falling out over something really stupid. Mm-hmm. We didn't talk for years. That led me to go and start Ego Trip and other things, right? And everything worked out the way it was supposed to work out. But we didn't have, as black youth in the inner city, in single-parent homes, we didn't have, like, that uncle who owned a business who could have pulled us both aside and said, come on, y'all, this is stupid. Like, right. come on, you know? And we were at a point where, right around the same time as The Source, like, if we would have kept it together, who knows where we would have been. So in the inner city, when you watch the film, most of these guys didn't have two parents in the home, mm-hmm. right? And so the mom, who was amazing, holding us down always, has to wear many hats. And then the kids have to wear different hats. So I think that going back to my idea of history being our friend, look at what it means to be this and be in this environment. Look at what it means to have an opportunity, because what Wu-Tang really represents is an opportunity
yeah.
and everyone working as a team. That's an important message in the hood,
right?
Right. Ego is always going to be a part of it, because we're in a capitalist society, and we feel like we are less than if we don't have that fly television set, mm-hmm. right? It's been programmed in us. And, you know, me and Nas went to junior high together. You know, I was a couple of years older than him. He dropped out real early, right? He's going to taste fruits that I will never taste, right? He's going to travel the world and do things I may never do, but I'm happy for him.
Mm. Yeah.
I'm proud of him because I know where he came from, right? And that brings us straight to Nipsey Hussle, mm-hmm. right? And slavery, right? Be happy for your brother or your sister. Celebrate them. Nas's success is mine. I don't have the zeros in my account, but his success, knowing that he went to 126 and they told him the same thing that they told me, you guys should go to vocational school. And don't get me wrong, we need more people in vocational school, and we need that job. We need those jobs. But what if Nas would have gone to vocational school?
Yeah.
This is what they have for us. This is what they have planned for us.
Mm-hmm.
So we have to learn to work as a team, to celebrate one another and encourage one another, because you might not have as much money as the head, i.e. RZA. And that's what I think Wu-Tang recognizes. At the end of the day, like U-God says, yo, at the end of the day, these guys are my family. Yeah. And if you look at it from that perspective, look at your own family. Think about that aunt you don't talk to or your mom doesn't mess with for some reason. Wu-Tang is no different.
It's no different. And, you know, it's interesting as you tell these stories. I was sharing with you off the mic that, you know, King Tech and I have been real close to RZA since 93, you know, and we were hear about all these things that were taking place within the crew. We didn't understand why the crew was breaking up. Like, you know, people were going off doing their own separate things. But this docuseries really touches on some sensitive areas that I'm glad you were able to get them to speak on, especially around ODB, RZA's cousin. And it was a clip in there that I saw when ODB, I think, had just got out.
Joined Rockefeller,
and he couldn't understand why RZA wouldn't let him out of his contract.
His new manager, Jared, wasn't going to have me do shit. I wasn't signing shit for him.
RZA says he won't sign off on it. It's a problem.
Fuck you mean you let everybody else go? You going to give me a problem? He dissing me now. You know what I'm saying?
I think he wants to be compensated. Do you think it's him or do you think it's divine?
It's both of them, man. You know what I'm saying? Acting like motherfucking bowling pins, man. Fuck you mean 8, 10, 9 niggas left Wu-Tang and you gonna still keep me like I'm some type of fucking pussy? Fuck wrong with that motherfucker? He ain't thinking right or something?
That right there was really, I don't know if that was the first time RZA has saw that. I don't know. But when the fellas was watching that clip in a movie theater, you know, that was kind of hard to watch, you know. How did they respond to that, watching ODB and just bringing all those moments?
I mean, if you notice, there are moments where some guys are crying.
Yeah.
And that's another powerful thing about this film. People, black men talking about depression, mm-hmm. black men crying on camera. Mm-hmm. You know, for RZA, he left me alone. Like, the guys didn't see anything for a long time. Right? They left me alone. RZA left me alone. And he came to the office to screen it. And that episode, I was like, I'm not going to sit in a room with him because, you know, I don't know how he's going to feel. And it's emotional. Uh-huh. And like he says in the film, like the reason why he didn't let him go was because he was like, it all started with me and him.
Yeah.
You know, and he said that he was super hurt. And then he says, but, you know, he had his mother and his aunt, you know, my aunt called me. So eventually he let him out, but he still winds up working with him.
Uh-huh.
You know, so it's complicated.
It's complicated, as these things are.
There's also a scene. People say things were better when we were broke. Like, you hear people say that a lot. It was simpler mm-hmm. back then. And then there's this, to me, what was very powerful. I watched Method Man go back to where he worked, and he just, like, embraced his old boss, and he's like, I remember when I used to sweep, and I remember, and it was like this twinkle in his eye. Were you there when that you shot that, and how genuine was that, and how real? Because he sounded like he remembered like his first Christmas almost. It was so crazy to me.
I mean, and that's the thing, it's like we've all been programmed to believe that. I'm not saying that you felt that, but of course, you know, he talked about how he hated selling drugs,
mm-hmm. yeah,
right?
Yeah, yeah.
So he took pride in the job that he had, you know?
That's what really, I felt, yeah.
It meant something to him. And for him to go back and, you know, okay, he's talking to the white boss, mm-hmm. you know? But that's not the dynamic. The dynamic right. is this family was kind enough to give me an opportunity, and I worked hard, and I appreciated it so much that I was happy to come back, even in my success. And then there are people who are still working there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know,
that been like, there all that time. Right?
Not everyone's gonna make it as a rapper. Yeah. He might still be working there if he didn't make it as Method Man.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
But
mm-hmm.
he took pride in having a job, and that's the thing with Wu-Tang. Sure, they sold drugs, but they worked hard. There's a lot of hard work that went into it. And when we have opportunities, we don't have social capital; we have cultural capital.
Mm-hmm.
And when the cultural capital mixes with the business, it's powerful. But when that happens, and you have no idea how it works, that's when the problems pop up.
Sasha Jenkins is here. We're talking about Wu-Tang Clan of Mics and Men, available now on Showtime. Alan in Maryland, did you see the docuseries?
Alan, what's popping?
Hey, Al.
What's going on, family? What's going on? Man, that docuseries was amazing.
Yeah.
Sasha, man, you put your foot in that one. Thank I'm you. A native New Yorker. I grew up in Queens, you know, in the era of Run-DMC next door to Hollis. And just to watch this film and being such a big fan of the Wu, man, it was powerful.
Wow.
And like you said earlier, the scene where the brothers are sitting in the theater and they're watching ODB and the emotions on their face and they're crying to see black men be like, yo, you know, I know we're being filmed and all that stuff, but man, that was our brother. And it was just amazing. You know, and just to also reiterate, there was not nine, it's 10 members of the Wu officially. A lot of people seem to think that Capo was just here and there. But he was, you know, he wasn't there in the beginning, but it was officially 10 members of the Wu.
All right. Yep. Thank you, Alan. You're a citizen, man.
That's Sway in the morning, homie.
JR from Richmond, did you watch the docuseries?
Yeah, I called the docuseries powerful, powerful, Sasha.
Thank
you. I just
want
to let you know you did an amazing job. Just want to tell you guys a real quick story. Probably 92, 93, went on a sixth grade field trip, Washington, D.C., went up in Sam Goody, if y'all remember the Sam Goody music stores. And I saw Enter the 36 Chambers, and this little white kid I was with, he's laughing, making jokes, and something just drew me to the CD. I had $20 in my pocket my mom gave me.
Yeah.
The whole ride home, I listened to that CD. Completely changed my life. Next 2 days, you know, I'm screaming Wu-Tang Clan ain't nothing to fuck with. My mom is looking at me like I'm crazy.
All right. Hey,
it's
man, you're a citizen, man.
It's way in the morning.
Eric, real quick, what's your question
what up,
for
E?
Sasha?
Hey.
Yo, what's going on, y'all? Yo, it's Eric Notes, man. I love the crew. Y'all know me. No stranger. Sasha, you know, first I want to say, you know, like everybody else, great job on the docuseries and
thank
all that. And we really do appreciate you doing that for the culture because I think I speak for a lot of people. We've been waiting on the breakdown of Wu-Tang for a long time, and it was well overdue. And I think it's real important because, you know, my kids just turned 13, my oldest, and, you know, now they got to sit down and watch it and break it down.
See,
you
that's
know?
Dope. That's what I love yeah. about it, man. Thank you, Eric. You're a citizen.
Sway in the morning.
Sasha, I want to say continued success. Whatever you're doing, you got to lane up here, man.
Appreciate right? that.
And like you, this platform is a part of your platforms, okay? And... those starting five MCs y'all got over there at Mass Appeal, y'all got some serious hyenas in the stable right now, bro. I love what y'all doing over at Mass Appeal. Thank you, Sasha Jenkins.
Thanks for having me.
Absolutely, man.